Today, the entirety of Texas is being threatened by illegal dumping. Through a combination of willful aquarium dumping and escapees via flooding, invasive animals are invading Texas and destroying the environment we all enjoy. From our rivers, to our rice fields, to our bays, they're seen everywhere, harming native animals and plants, along with harming the Texas economy. Perios volatons, common name lionfish, has recently become a major issue for coastal conservation agencies. The lionfish has several reddish-brown stripes over a white body, along with venom-filled spines that causes extreme pain in those stung and even serious injuries in those who are allergic. They can grow up to 17 inches in length. They are originally from the West Pacific Ocean, but have now invaded the Caribbean, the Gulf of Mexico, and the southern Atlantic coast, living in coral reefs and mangroves. Their spread throughout the United States has largely been due to illegal aquarium dumping by pet owners. These illegally dumped fish then travel throughout American waters to several states, including Texas. Another major factor in their spread is their ability to quickly reproduce, with females laying 2,000 to 15,000 eggs annually. In the Bahamas, where the climate is just right for lionfish, females can lay over 2 million eggs annually. The lionfish eats a wide variety of prey that includes crustaceans, invertebrates, and larvae of herbivores. Due to being an invasive species, the lionfish has very few natural predators and so are able to eat fish larvae without limit, leading to a reduction in native population. The lionfish's diet of herbivore larvae weakens local habitats as lionfish outcompetes other predators. All of this translates to a major hit to not only our local ecosystems, but to the economy, as several jobs depend upon the continued use of the resources garnered from the habitats that these fish upset. If someone is looking to get rid of a lionfish, it is encouraged that they freeze it overnight, place it in a bag, and then throw it away. Conservation groups are looking at encouraging the hunting of lionfish and the sale of it as a delicacy in order to limit the already established populations in Texas. China argus, common name Northern Snakehead, is a major threat against the future of Texas ecosystems. Its long cylindrical body has a very long underside fin near to its tail and a small fin near to its head, which differentiates it from the native bullfin. They can grow up to 31 inches long and have a max weight of 15 pounds. Northern snakehead is originally from Africa and Southern Asia, but has now invaded the states of California, Florida, Maryland, and more. They mostly live in swamps, lakes, and rivers, and while they have yet to invade Texas, the threat that it poses is a major issue. The northern snakehead lays between 1.3 thousand to 15,000 eggs every 1 to 5 times a year. Along with gills, they have a lung-like organ that allows them to survive out of water for several days. Some species are able to burrow into the ground or even travel over land to other bodies of water. In the states that the northern snakehead has invaded, they have decimated local habitats by attacking several native species. They have also been known to attack humans who approach their nests. This has led to injuries throughout regions they have overrun. Preventing the spread of northern snakeheads to Texas is key to protecting our ecosystems. Texans are encouraged to report any sighting of a living snakehead to Texas Parks and Wildlife. Except with a special permit, it is illegal to release, import, sell, purchase, transport, or breed snakeheads. These laws try to limit the devastating effects of snakeheads, however, they can only truly make a difference through the continued support of citizens who spread awareness about the issue and ill effects of northern snakeheads on the environment in both Texas and abroad. Pomacea maculata, common name Apple Snail, has spread throughout Texas, attacking vegetation and straining the economy. Though they are usually sized around 1.5 inches high, they can grow up to 6 inches or about the size of a fist. They come in colors ranging from brown to black to yellow, and their size is a key indication of their species. They are originally from South America but have now invaded several states, from Alabama to Hawaii to California to Georgia and more. Their main habitats are freshwater rivers, ponds, and rice fields. And in Texas, they have now invaded several bays, from Austin Oyster to Buffalo San Jacinto to West Galveston Bay. They have largely spread to these locations via illegal dumping from pet owners and flooding, transporting them across vast distances. The Apple Snail lays 500 to 700 eggs during warmer months every 5 to 14 days. The clumps of eggs are color pink and are laid just above the waterline, usually the first sign of their invasion. These eggs can persist long after their hatching, eventually fading to white. Apple snails eat a wide range of vegetation, including rice. They can also burrow into the ground in order to survive heavy drought. Apple snails' diet of a wide range of vegetation, such as the ones that natives rely on, has led to them outcompeting local animals, greatly harming ecosystems. Their diet of rice has also led to an increase of farm maintenance in rice fields and an increase in rice prices. The apple snail also acts as a host for the rat lungworm larvae, which causes a disease which can have long-term ill health effects in mammals, including humans. The key way to limit apple snail's effects is prevention of its spread. Diligence by Texans and an understanding of the dangers of illegal dumping is being encouraged by TPWD in order to accomplish their goal of conservation. Due to chemicals often harming the habitats that the apple snail invades, Texans are encouraged to forego chemicals in favor of simply removing any eggs they find and crushing them before throwing away the remnants. The eggs should never be dropped in the water, as the apple snails do not easily drown. Monoperus albus, common name Asian swamp eel, has spread throughout several states in the US and has had devastating consequences on native populations. They can grow up to 3 feet and come in colors ranging from dark brown to light green to olive, with most specimens having a slightly lighter underside and spots. They have an overhanging upper jaw with a set of brittle teeth and V-shaped gills on their throat. While they are nicknamed eel, they are not in fact eels, as they have no scales, fins on the sides of their body, or paired gills on both sides of their head, all key marks of eels. Asian swamp eels are of course native to a wide swath of Asia, from India to China. Today, they have invaded the states of Florida, Georgia, Hawaii, and New Jersey. It lives in habitats that include ponds, canals, rice fields, and even ditches, as it can survive slightly salty water. While they have yet to reach Texas, the possibility of them spreading here is a major issue. The Asian swamp eel lays more than 400 eggs at a time, and they go through a process known as sequential hermaphroditism, meaning they are all born as females before some of them mature into males. The Asian swamp eel is nocturnal, meaning they hunt their prey of frogs, shrimp, turtle eggs, and other invertebrates at night. During the day, they rest in burrow systems that can be as deep as 5 feet. In the event of flooding, it can actually swim over land, as it can survive in water with low oxygen levels and even out of water for months. The Asian swamp eel is an opportunistic predator, meaning they will eat a wide range of fishes, amphibians, and invertebrates wherever they invade. This harms the entire food web and leads to the destabilization of ecosystems. They might in fact have an even worse effect in habitats they attack, but being a nocturnal, human observation of wild specimens is extremely difficult. Asian swamp eels have largely been spread due to aquarium dumpings by citizens ignorant of their effects or escapees from fish markets. Preventing the spread of Asian swamp eels to Texas is key to protecting our ecosystems. Texans are encouraged to report any sighting of a swamp eel to Texas Parks and Wildlife, who will investigate thoroughly. Certain conservation agencies are also looking into using electroshocking of swamp eels and manually clearing them out in order to curb existing populations. Hypostomus, Plecostomus, and Plerygoplichthys anisthesi, common name armored catfishes or LORIICARIDS, are currently invading Texas and destabilizing our riverbeds, harming our economy and attacking our ecosystems. While they only grow up to 3 inches as pets, in the wild they can grow up to 3 feet. Unlike other catfishes, LORIICARIDS do not have barbels, aka cat whiskers, on their face. They do have a small spiny fin between their large spiny back fin and tail fin, however. They also have a sucking mouth on the underside of their head and scaly skin. Loricarids are originally from Central and South America, but have now invaded several states including Florida, Nevada, and Texas. They live in habitats that include rivers, bayous, and canals, and in Texas they have overran several bodies of water, such as the San Antonio River, the San Felipe Creek, and the San Marcos River. They have largely been spread via their illegal dumping by pet owners and people trying to limit algae growth. Females lay 300 plus eggs in burrows which males guard for 4 to 20 days, with the length being determined by their species. The diet largely consists of algae eating off almost any surface. Normal catfish's burrows cause riverbeds to destabilize. This can lead to an increase in salt and clog river traffic, along with making the river more inhospitable to native animals. They also cause an increase in fish costs as they devastate fisheries by outcompeting game fish. The armored catfish also outcompetes other natives over algae, leading to an unsustainable food web in areas they invade. Armored catfish have largely been spread due to aquarium dumping by owners ignorant of their true effects. Preventing the spread of loricarids in Texas is key to protecting our ecosystem and economy. If someone is looking to get rid of an armored catfish, they are encouraged to freeze it overnight, place it in a bag, and then throw it away. Some conservation agencies are even looking into encouraging the eating of armored catfish in order to curb populations that have already been established in Texas. Shrimp imported from outside the Gulf of Mexico can carry diseases that greatly harm shellfish populations when the shrimp are used as bait. While these diseases don't harm humans once shrimp have been cooked, they often cause disastrous effects on shellfish populations and in turn the economy. Due to federal law, all packaged shrimp have labels detailing where they were farmed. These labels can be used to make sure your bait shrimp is in fact from the Gulf of Mexico. Some of the major shrimp importers in Texas are Venezuela, Thailand, and California. Some common imported species are the Pacific white, the white leg, the Pacific blue, the tiger, and the yellow leg shrimps. Some shrimp species that are usually safe to use in Texas are the brown shrimp, the northern white shrimp, the pink shrimp, and the mantis shrimp. The diseases which these imported bait shrimp can spread include the common white spot syndrome, which rapidly kills shellfish. Not only are the shellfish prize goods in themselves, but they also serve as the basis of several game fish's diet, thus their deaths harm the economy in several ways. The Texas State Legislature has passed a law making the use of non-Gulf of Mexico shrimp as bait illegal in Texas. While this is a major factor in preserving shellfish populations and the economy, it should always be remembered that the biggest factor in conservation is public awareness. Teaching the public about the dangers and legality of using imported shrimp as bait is a major part of Texas Parks and Wildlife's action plan. The illegal dumping of animals and plants have harmed Texas in several respects. But through the actions of conservation agencies and Texans dedicated to protecting our future, we can fight back. It is vital that we always remember that we are part of the environment and that our actions have consequences, both for good and for bad. Through the actions of everyday Texans and Texas Parks and Wildlife, we can make sure that those actions result in good outcomes, so that our future as a state is one where our habitats are secure and our economy is thriving.